Well, welcome to Psalm 32 that we're studying now. And this one is an important one, again, because of how the New Testament verifies that original meaning. Psalm 32, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, in whose spirit is no deceit. And then the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 4 is speaking about this, the way that forgiveness comes as this free gift, and it comes to those who are sinners, outsiders, not just perfect people who are insiders. So so Romans 4 verse 5, to the one who does not work or does not strive in their own strength to fix themselves, but rather to the one who trusts God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. So let's just understand what's being said there, that a person who is ungodly and there's no reason to believe that they're going to be accepted as right with the living God, but nevertheless, against all hope kind of thing, they trust God because God is saying, come to me, I will fix you, I will welcome you, I'll forgive you. I'm the way, the truth and the life. That's what Jesus says. And we, and instead of thinking, but I can't be fixed, I'm not good enough, and so on. Instead, if we just trust him, and it says here, the faith is credited as righteousness, that simply trusting him is like equivalent to doing the right thing. And we might say, but that isn't the same, like, it's not the same as having lived a perfect life of always doing the right thing. Well, the living God is saying, if you trust me to handle that, the perfect life stuff, the fixing your heart, your future, your past, if you just trust me to handle that, I will regard you as if you have done the right thing, as you will be you will be righteous in my eyes. That's what it's saying. And so Romans 4 verse 6, David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness of the one to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. So God, remember, is giving this sort of righteous status to a person who hasn't done the right things. They haven't done the right things, but they trust God to sort that out through Jesus. And so God says, well, that is doing the right thing, trusting in Jesus, trusting that I know how to fix you, to make you right. That is the right thing. So just trusting is the right thing. And I regard that as you've done what is right, and therefore you're right with me. And then he quotes this psalm, Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. And then Paul goes on to discuss, is this only for people inside church, circumcised or uncircumcised? You know, is it based in some way on things we've done? And he's like, no, not at all. And that he's going to go on to show that Abraham was regarded as right with God before he was circumcised. Okay, so back we go to Psalm 32. That's how it begins. It's saying that blessedness, remember, Jesus is the blessed man who's always done the right thing. Psalm 1 is always in our minds. We're often thinking of Psalm 1 and Psalm 2 to orientate us in all these Psalms. Psalm 1, the blessed man, always does what's right. But here, blessed is the one who, and we've seen that if we take refuge in Jesus, we're blessed. So here, blessed is someone who's not done all the right things, but whose sins are dealt with, taken away, covered, That means atoned for. Blessed is the person who the Lord doesn't look at what they've actually done, their sins, but looks at them as the person who's done the right thing because they trust him. Now, with all that, the reason I've labored that slightly is because it is a very hard thing for us as ungodly sinners to believe and to take in, to confess our sins, to just be open and honest about the fact that we are ungodly sinners, to speak that out truly, honestly, fully, be like that, open, not pretending, not trying to fix ourselves, to say, to be like that, and then put our trust in our Savior God. That's the easiest thing in the world, but it's the hardest thing in the world because it goes against our instinct, sort of. Now, what this psalm really is about is the Lord Jesus Christ showing us how to do that. He is modeling in this psalm for us how to not hold in our sin, not hold in the burden of sin and guilt and shame. But when we're feeling that and it's draining us and making us weary, depressed, overwhelmed by it all, instead of holding it in, letting it out, confessing our sins, being honest, and then as the sin, you know, if we confess our sins, the scripture tells us he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So Lord, Jesus himself shows us how to do that. And if you notice verse 8, he says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Don't be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. So you can see there's an image of us. We're supposed to come to him, and we shouldn't be like an animal that has to kind of be forced to do so against its will, because that's no good. He wants us to have understanding, to get what is going on, and to come to him and learn from him how to confess our sins and trust, and therefore do the right thing in the eyes of God. That's the right thing. And we need to learn from Jesus how to do that. But right, so the choice again, the wicked have woes. You can see that in verse 10. And they're constantly drained by their sin. And living with sin is the hardest thing in all the world. And we think giving up sin is a hardship. Actually, living with sin is the greatest hardship of all. And Jesus is going to teach us that. And that when we follow his way, do what he's teaching us to do in Psalm 32, then we can know, verse 11, rejoice in the Lord, be glad, you righteous, sing, all you who are upright in heart. That's the goal, to get to that. The pathway to do that is this confession and trust. Now then, Andrew Bonar again, this lovely book, can I get it? Christ and His Church in the Book of Psalms, Andrew Bonar. He's brilliant at understanding how these psalms are the prayers of Jesus. And let me read a little bit from it. We generally take up this psalm as if it was for the members of Christ, but we should not forget that Christ himself traversed the way of forgiveness. He, Christ, stood for us in our room, in our very place. He stood as substitute, and the sins of all that great multitude which no man can number, all those sins were upon him, laid upon him by imputation. He bore all our sins himself. So dreadful was his position, so truly awful did it seem to him to be reckoned a sinner, that even this, apart from the wrath and curse, would have been sufficient to make him cry, bless the man to whom the Lord does not impute sin. So he's saying, like, let me just pause there. Andrew Bonar is saying, Christ felt the weight of sin to be carrying the burden of our sin, felt it so intensely that even if we forget the actual experience of the cross, where the, on the cross he's bearing the wrath of God and the judicial curse against sin, even leaving aside that sense of the wrath of God and the judicial curse, to merely feel the weight of sin upon him, the guilt and the shame of our sin weighing upon him, is enough to make him cry out, blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute sin, like the weight of it, and to feel that he doesn't, it's lifted from him, is it's such a blessed thing to get out from under the weight of the sin. But he is carrying it all. And Andrew Bonar goes on, he, Jesus Christ, was dumb for our sakes. And this is now picking up from verses 3 to 7. Particularly now, verses 3 and 4, that when he's expressing the weight of it, he's dumb for us, his bones waste away, he groaned from day to day, and during the lonesome hours of midnight was kept awake by our woe. So Andrew Bonner's there entering into this sense that, say, at least from the time of his baptism by John the Baptist, when he's officially becoming the lamb that bears the sins of the world, all the way through to his death on the cross, throughout that time, he's the sin bearer and feels the weight of it and the groaning, the burden of it, the heaviness upon him, and waking up in the night feeling the sense that he is this sin bearer is an intense thing for him. And he's showing us, what do we do when we feel the weight of sin upon us? Again, Andrew Bonar, verse 4, his moisture or his life, strength, it's literally moisture, was sapped. Vigor and vitality, it is, changed through the drought of summer. And so there, that sense of the excessive heat. So bearing the sins is like an excessive heat upon him, draining the moisture, the life from him. It's an intolerable burden burning down upon him. In this state, this is Andrew Bonar again, Jesus Christ acknowledged our sin. It was only ours he had to acknowledge. Not, he didn't have to confess his own sin. It's only our sin he's acknowledging and bearing. So in this state, he acknowledged our sin, only ours he had to acknowledge, and he spread it out before God on the cross. He continued to do so till it was forgiven to him as our substitute. So that's the burden of the psalm. Jesus experiences it. Verse 5, then I acknowledged my sin to you and didn't cover up my iniquity. I'll confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. So that is what essentially he's doing on the cross. He's bringing it all out into the open, manifesting the horror of sin on the cross. It's all nailed up on the cross for all to see. He makes a public display of it rather than hiding it. If we want to see sin truly exposed, and is that nakedness of the crucified God on the cross bearing our sins, nothing so confesses sin as that does. And therefore, there is forgiveness. And therefore, you forgave the guilt of my sin. And then verses 6 and 7, that sense of church taking refuge in him. So that's Psalm 32. Wonderful psalm. Jesus, I love verse 8 when he says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go, counsel you with my loving eye on you. And don't be like a stubborn horse or mule that only comes when it's forced to do so. We should come to him for this instruction, willingly and joyfully with understanding.